Hey, good morning, everybody. We want to welcome you guys to Christ Church on the Move. It's a beautiful day. I want to start out on the foot of saying Happy Father's Day.
Happy Father's Day.
You dads out there, we appreciate you. We wouldn't be here without you. I guess technically we do need you. Yeah, so Happy Father's Day. Technically we need you. So anyway, we want to invite you. Please stand. Now listen, it's a treat to be in the Father's house. Mm-hmm. It's a treat to be with a bunch of cool fathers here. I think we can worship with some of that in the mix today. Come to the well that never runs dry. Drink of the water, come and thirst no more. Come on, you sinners, come find his mercy. Come to the table, he will satisfy. Taste of his goodness and find what you're looking for. Come lay them down at the foot of the cross. Jesus is waiting there, oh, with open arms. For God so loved the world that he gave us his one and only son to save us. Whoever believes in him will live forever.
Come lay them down at the foot of the cross. Jesus is waiting.
God so
loved the world.
Good morning. Happy Father's Day, everybody. I want to welcome everybody here. If it's your first or second time being here, if you would take a time to fill out a connection card for us, drop an offering plate just so we know we're here. We'd love to meet you. We're going to continue worshiping. Glad to see everybody this morning.
So we're going to invite you guys. Take a few seconds, all right? Okay. A lot of people just made their way in. Hey, listen, we can roll with that gear.
I'm telling you.
Find the few men around. Just shake their hands. Look them in the eye. Tell them Happy Father's Day. Tell them we love you. Thanks for being here. Say some love this morning
Stay
to
right
some people
there.
Near you.
I've got a Bible here that was left in the ladies' room. Is it anybody's? If a man comes up, I know we're in trouble. Oh, Miss Leslie. Okay.
It's good that she brings the Bible.
That's right. Why don't you be seated for right now? And because we got some important business to take care of. For those of you who don't know me, I'm Pastor Ann, and my husband and I are the kids' pastors here, and you know him. So that's all you get. We have had a great week here. We had our family fest this
check,
week.
Check.
Yeah, you don't have to turn him on. It's okay. We had our family fest this week, and what an exciting time, right, guys? It was so fun for the adults and the kids. But all the way through, we were raising money. Raising money. If you remember, I told you about 2 or 3 months ago how the kids, after Easter, our lesson on go into all the world. And so the kids decided that they were going to do a missions project to help a pastor in India raise money for a Vespa so that he could ride to the 6 churches that he pastors over there. And so we joined and partnered with Stirring Waters, which is Mr. Bill's. And he's not here today, he told me. It is Stirring Waters. They are raising money for a disabled kids water park out at Lake Aurora. And so we partnered with them because he's got the giant canoes, and we did a paddle challenge then. But then during Family Fest, we did a fun dunker challenge. And the fun dunker challenge is where the boys are against the girls, and they bring money, we count it, and whoever loses gets balloons of water, and well, some of them had mustard and chocolate in them.
It was so, very nasty.
Yes.
It was a great experience.
And it was not a great experience, but for the very first time in all the challenges that I do with this man, I lost. But I want you to know
why. No, you didn't just lose. You lost big. She walks into my office and says, Steve, you're going down. The girls are going to win. There's not a chance.
And while I'm doing that, saying that, he's texting all the men's Bible study. Saying, I need
help.
Hey,
let's roll the video. Let's roll the video.
Here we go.
Let's watch this.
Before you give that, will you give us the total?
I can give you the total.
Can you give us the whole total?
So for 3 days,
that might be good math.
The girls and the boys, $1,155.82.
That was at Family Fest.
Now watch this.
Yep.
Watch her reaction.
Oh my goodness.
That's when she realizes what happened.
Okay, so the girls total, $366.36. And the boys, $789.46.
Yeah.
So, Pastor Ann?
She said 700. Oh. I'm using my fingers because you have to do that.
5 loaves, 2 fish.
Almost 800.
Almost 800.
Yes. For some reason, I think there was a little bit of conniving going on here.
Listen, you called out the boys. The boys don't mess around.
All right. I will be strong, and I will accept these balloons on my head.
So.
The boys won. And let's, now, okay, what's the next slide? Here it all is. Now, Pastor Steve did say, I'll take, you know, because we talked about the fruit of the Spirit that night. So he says, I will use the fruit of the Spirit and volunteer to take some of the balloons. So we both took the balloons, and they were cold, yes. But here again was the total of the Family Fest. That was the total of Family Fest, $1,145. Now, let's add that to the total of the paddle challenge, where the kids got in the canoes, and that was $820. So a total for the scooter and for Stirring Waters. Let's see. Oh, did you already change it? Oh, I was leading
just,
up to
she's
it.
She's just following you.
I was leading. Anyway, our grand total was $1,965. Isn't that awesome? Isn't God good? God is good and uses men who connive behind my back to still reach his totals. So we are very excited. So, yes, congratulations.
Well, I'm looking forward to the next challenge.
On your one and only challenge you will ever win for me. All right. Have a wonderful worship. I'm going to take the kids. We're going to go back out. Happy Father's Day to all you fathers.
All right, I want to do something. If you're comfortable with this, close your eyes and imagine. I'm going to read to you Revelations 1. I'm going to start at 13. So talking about Jesus. John saw Jesus in heaven, and this is what he says. Among the lampstands was someone like a son of man, dressed in a robe reaching down to his feet, and with a golden sash around his chest. The hair on his head was white like wool, as white as snow, and his eyes were like a blazing fire. His feet were like bronze glowing in a furnace, and his voice was like the sound of rushing waters. In his right hand he held 7 stars, and coming out of his mouth was a sharp double-edged sword. His face was like the sun shining in all its brilliance. When I saw him, I fell at his feet as though dead. Then he placed his right hand on me and said, "Do not be afraid. I am the first and the last. I am the living one. I was dead, and now look, I am alive forever and ever, right? And I hold the keys of death and Hades." This is our King. Let's worship our King. Stand with me. My great King.
There was a moment when the lights went out, when death had claimed its victory. The King of Love had given up his life. The darkest day in history. There on a cross they made for sinners. For every curse his blood atoned. One final breath and it was finished. But not the end we could have known. For the earth began to shake. And the veil was torn. What sacrifice was made as the heavens roared. And all hail, King Jesus. Jesus, all hail the
such a light breaking through. When all was lost, he crossed eternity. The King of Life was on the move. For in a dark old tomb, where our Lord was laid, one miraculous breath, we're forever changed. And all hail King Jesus, sing to your King. Love you, Lord, and joy, my King. In what you hear, let it be a sweet, sweet sound in your ear.
Come on.
I love you, Lord. Joy, my King.
That every beat of your heart is a testimony to God's gracious power. Every bird that sings, every flower that blooms, every step you take in your life is God showing us what He's capable of. I pray today that all of us know how much He loves us. He would send His Son to die in my place, looking at all the sin that I'm capable of, all the sin that I'm going to commit, all of the sin of the world, and saying it's worth it. I will do that because I love you. Jesus, we thank you for that love. We thank you so much for that sacrifice. We thank you so much for that heart that never gives up, that is a father even when every sign on the planet points in a different direction of what that should look like, that brings us into your family. We thank you. We worship you. We love you. We sing this. We pray this. We hold this in the name of Jesus. As people said,
amen.
Please be seated.
Hey, guys. Hey. Just want to pray real quick before I start talking. God, thank you so much. Thank you so much for your son. Thank you so much for what we're about to partake in communion to remember what he did for us. And I pray that whatever I say is your Holy Spirit speaking through me and moving through me and nothing of my own flesh. And I pray that it's received and that this church will just be on fire for you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, so 1 Corinthians 11:23. For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he also took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you will proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Whoever therefore eats the bread or drinks of the cup in an unworthy manner will be guilty concerning the body and the blood of the Lord. Let a person examine himself then, and so eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without discerning the body eats and drinks judgment on himself. That is why many of you are weak and ill, and some have died. But if we judge ourselves truly, we would not be judged. But when we are judged by the Lord, we are disciplined, so that we may not be condemned along with the world." So when I was like high school, teenager, early 20s, the only time I would go to church would be if we were having Christmas at my cousin's house, and we would go to a Christmas Eve service. And there was a Lutheran church, and so they would do communion a little different than what we do. But you would get up and come forward and take communion. And me and my parents would always just sit there, and we'd never get up and go take communion. And I never really knew why. I didn't really care, to be honest with you. And I asked my mom, I don't remember when I asked her, maybe a couple years ago, I said, "Why did we never get up?" And she said, "Well, because we weren't a member of that church." And so some churches, some bodies think that you have to be a member to take communion in their church, blah, blah, blah. We're not going to like go down that road. But I am grateful that I did not take communion, because I could care less about Jesus at that time in my life. I was probably high at the service. I guarantee you I've been doing everything I've been doing for years and years and years, living for the world. What would have been the point of me taking that blood and that, you know, I had no respect for Jesus. I had no love for Jesus. I could not even fathom what he did for me, because I just didn't care. I didn't have any, I mean, I think you guys get what I'm saying. So I continued on to that. You know, this is presented in front of me. This is an answer to all the things that I've been trying to fill. All the things I'm doing in the world that I'm trying to make me happy. The world's going to say it's going to make me happy. We know what those things are. I've been doing that and doing that and doing that. I'm sitting in front of my option for something better, and I still deny it. And I denied that for years. And the only time that it took me becoming suicidal, depressed, anxious, like driven to madness, to finally think, obviously this isn't working. Why am I not trying that? And so what I want to tell you guys today, you don't have to wait till that point. You might be at that point right now. You might be on the path to that point, but stop waiting if that's you. If you are a believer, it says examine. If you've given your life to the Lord and you're following Jesus, and none of us are perfect or we wouldn't be taking communion. But before I take this cup, before you take this cup, if you're a believer, it says examine yourself. Examine yourself. Ask God, repent. Don't take this knowing that you're sinning. You're not expected to be perfect. None of us are. But do not take of the cup without repenting. Do not take of the cup if you don't believe it, because there's no point. And it says, you've taken this, and some of you are sick, and some of you have died. And we're sitting up here singing about Jesus. Jackie's reading out a revelation about the power of Jesus. The power of Jesus is enough to clean us all, right? Okay? And we can't take this cup. And he says, "This is my blood. This is my body." And we're just going to be like, "Meh, I'm going to go do whatever I want after this." Don't do that. Okay? I've spoke up here a lot of times, and it's just me rambling about whatever, and then I try to spin it into a communion in the last 30 seconds. But, like, seriously, guys, this is the most powerful thing. Like, the death, the gospel, that Jesus sent his, that God sent his son Jesus to die for us so that we could be saved, and that we remember that by taking these, this blood and this body. Do not take it lightly, please. And so I think I've given instructions that are, but guys, if you are, whatever you're going through, this is the answer. Jesus is the answer. Stop looking for your answers in the world. I've done that for a long time. It's not going to work. I promise you, it's not going to work. Whatever it is that you're, yeah, this is it. And so just, and let's stop acting like we're okay. All right? If there's this many people in the room, and at the end of the service, like, who needs prayer, and nobody comes forward, you don't have to come forward. Turn to the person next to you. Ask the person next to you, can I pray for you? Do you need prayer? We are not okay. There's 200 people here. You're not okay. All right? You need prayer. You need prayer. I need prayer. We all need prayer. All right. Let's do this. God, thank you so much. I love you so much, Lord. Thank you for this body. Thank you for everybody that's here right now. I pray that you're moving in the hearts of anybody who doesn't know you right now, that they would feel your Holy Spirit. They would know you love them. You have a plan for their life. I pray for any believers here that are, you know, in sin, doing things they know they're not supposed to be doing, things that are not of you, that you would convict them. They would repent, and they would feel that grace that you've given us, and that joy and that love. They would just feel loved, and just waves of love over everybody in this room right now, because that's what you are. You love us so much that you sent your son to die for us, and I'm thankful that we get to remember that in this moment. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. So, hey guys, I mean, last week was really cool, wasn't it? Like, it was a good experience. I don't know if you're here. We had an opportunity to have the Lake Wills High School staff come out and share some stories about what the impact has been made through our church's food drive. And it was so cool because there was so many people that came up afterwards and said, man, I really dig that. That was exciting to hear the testimonies of the students and just the opportunity to hear what our simple bring a bag of food has done in the lives of so many students. It was a really cool experience to see, and it's always exciting to see how God's moving in the life of our church. Amen? It's exciting to see what God can do through our generosity, and it tied right into the story that Jesus, that we saw in Luke's gospel, where Jesus takes little resources, 5 loaves and 2 fish, and he multiplies it and expands it and does incredible things. He's able to feed thousands with the small offering that is brought before him. God can do amazing things when we let him move with the resources that we have. And it's so cool to see. And you know, it was a cool week. It was a cool experience. Now, guys, I thought I did a pretty good job telling the story last Sunday. But that was before I saw Camp Runamuck's version of the feeding of the 5,000. We had an incredible experience. And, you know, Jody Miller, she had the adults up here. And they were telling the story of the feeding of the 5,000 in a rap round. Like, it was a wrap in a round, and I just want to show you a small snippet of it. There's a video. There we go.
Okay, this is the end. Song's almost done. It shows us that his church can have some fun, but the story is true. And when they were through, Jesus had them picking up basketfuls too.
1, 2, 3.
Pick it up now.
1, 2, 3. Pick it up now. 1, 2, 3. Pick it up.
Here we go, boys. Keep going. Don't stop.
Pick it up now. 1, 2, 3.
Ladies, go. Amen. Here we go. 2 fish. Here we go. You feed them.
Yeah. It's a way better version. I'm going to do it that way all the time now. So, no, not at all. But, guys, it fills me up. It fills me up to have moments where we have these cool experiences, to have moments where our families are connected and laughing and being silly together, to be able to be open and honest about who we are and just saying, you know, hey, let's have some fun together. Not to mention, it's always nice to see the boys win. Always. All right. It was a cool week. There's a lot of good memories, and I'm thankful for the experience. And like many of you, like, I enjoy having these moments where worship is powerful and we're swept away into this time of prayer, or the message just hits us right where we need to see it. To have these moments where we have childlike wonder at a thing like Family Fest and just get laugh again and tap into that youthful experience. It was a good experience. But sometimes there's a danger when we allow the experience to become our pursuit. Sometimes we long for those experiences, and we don't see those experiences. We wonder if we're missing something. Like, there's a problem when we start gauging our worship on what we feel and how we're moved. Like, how does that move me? There's a danger when we start looking for the show rather than looking for Jesus. And so I want to frame this message today, kind of where we are in the text. Like, following Jesus, it's not about the experience that we have. It's about the relationship we need. It's about the sacrifice that we're called to make. Because Jesus, he had no problem calling people out when they were only after the experience. He had no problem calling people out when they only expected what he could give to them. You guys remember what happens after the feeding of the 5,000? Remember that story that happens? You'll find it in John's gospel, John chapter 6. Jesus takes his disciples and they go to the other side of the lake, and the crowds, they start to wonder where Jesus went. They eventually figure out, oh, he went to the other side. And so they take off looking for Jesus. Like, their highest priority in this moment is to be where Jesus is. But there's a motive here. There's a motive in that reality. Jesus for them was their meal ticket. By the time they catch up to Jesus, they're starving. And they've missed a chance to order breakfast, and now they want to see what's on the lunch menu. And Jesus, he has no intention of keeping the all-you-can-eat buffet. He just fed the 5,000 there, a miraculous thing. But Jesus is done giving out free handouts in this moment. In fact, he calls the people out in John 6, verse 26. He says, I tell you the truth. He says, you're looking for me not because you saw miraculous signs, but because you ate the loaves and you had your fill. Jesus says very plainly, you're not here for me. It's not me you're looking for. You're here for the show. You're here for the spectacle. You're here for what you think I can give you. You're here for the food. You heard there was something free, and you wanted to get whatever that was. So you had a great experience last week, and you came back for more, and he said, unless you fill up on me, unless you fill up on me, unless you eat my flesh, and drink my blood, unless you feast on me, he says in John 6, you have no part in me. Who are you here for? Who are you here for? Jesus says plainly, you're not here for me. But he tells him, he says, I'm the bread of life. Verse 35, he who comes to me will never go hungry, and he who believes in me will never be thirsty. And so what Jesus is doing here in this moment in his ministry, he says, listen, guys, we need to define the relationship here. We need to define what's actually going on. Why are you here? Why do you want to follow me, Jesus says? What do you think is going to happen here? What are you hoping to find? At different points in our life, we have to have this conversation. We've got to define the relationship. Why are you here? What's your because? Is it because you saw free coffee and donuts and said, that's nice? It's because you think the seats are comfortable, the music's not so bad? It's because you like the people here, the groups of people that we have? Is there great programs for the kids? Is that why we come? Is that why we're here? Maybe your parents make you come. Maybe it's just what's expected of you. I'm supposed to be here. Like maybe at one point you came for a girl. You saw a cute boy. Said, hey, I'll hang around for a little bit. That's nice. At some point, though, it's got to be more than that, right? It's got to go deeper. Is it about Jesus or is it something else? Because here in John 6, Jesus challenges the crowd to a deeper, a more intimate relationship with him. He's inviting them to go deeper with him, to make a commitment. But many of the crowd, they don't like what Jesus has to say. In fact, in verse 60, it says, on hearing it, many of his disciples said, this is a hard teaching. I mean, who can accept it? And from this time on, many of his disciples turned back and no longer followed him. And so we look at that story. What about you? Are you here to feast on Jesus? Or is it something less? I mean, guys, if all we had was Jesus, would Jesus be enough? Like if we stripped away all the pleasantries and all the comfort and every convenience, if we knew beyond a shadow of doubt that there would be a struggle mixed into the joy of our experience, that this road that we walk is going to be hard, would we follow him even through the sacrifice, even through the hard times, even through the hurt? Because that's the challenge that we see Jesus make to his disciples as we turn the page in Luke's gospel. Luke chapter 9, we come to a very, very familiar verse. Verse 23, then he said to them all, whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves, take up their cross daily, and follow me. And my guess is if you've been around the block here in church, like you've heard this verse before. This is not a new statement. In fact, we've heard it so many times that it's probably lost its magnitude. It's probably lost its weight as we just kind of let it roll off our tongues. We glance at it so quickly, we just assume that we've got it. Oh, I understand that, yeah. And we come to this understanding, well, if anyone would come after me, then follow me. Jesus says, if anyone wants to come, follow me. And what we unconsciously do is we skip the middle part. We skip the weightier stuff of the text. And so what we get in churches all over the place is these Christians, all these followers of Jesus who want to get to heaven and they want to have their sins forgiven And they want to experience all the benefits of the cross without actually carrying the burden that Jesus invites us to carry with him. Jesus commanded us to follow, but he also said, take up your cross. And what many people want is Jesus without the cost. And it's become a prevalent thing in our churches all over the place. We say, come to Jesus. Come to Jesus. Look what he can do for you. Look what he can do. And we don't want them to not come. And so what do? Is we take away every expectation. Just come. All you got to do is come. Just come. And it's like this easy token, easy believism. It's painless. It's effortless. You just have to come. You just have to come. We give away a toaster oven with every baptism. We can't figure out why a majority of Christians don't look any different than the world. Guys, following Jesus isn't about the experience we have. It's about the relationship we need. It's about the sacrifice we're called to make. And don't miss this, guys. Jesus is the way to life. Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. And no one comes to the Father except through him. His death on the cross, it pays the price for our sins. He made the sacrifice that we could not make. There is nothing within me or you that could ever satisfy that order. Jesus paid the bill. And it is through him that we have life. He's promised eternal life to those who would believe. Those who trust. It is simple. You just have to trust in Jesus. He desires a relationship with each and every one of us. His invitation is to come. Anyone can come. Everyone can come. But I am doing a disservice to you and anybody else if I tell you there is no cost in making that decision. When we believe in Jesus and we follow him, he says persecution will come. It is a hard road. There is a cross to bear, but there is life at the end. Jesus says it's worth it. But make no mistake, there is a cost. We deny yourself. You're called to deny. You can't just live for you anymore. It's about what the kingdom of God is about. You can't just live for you and think about your own selfish desires. It's about what the person next to you might need. How can you love and serve and care for that individual as well? It's not just about you. I deny myself. And I take up my cross. Guys, to anyone who would have heard this phrase in the original context, the cross meant only one thing. And it wasn't jewelry around their neck. It wasn't an illuminated, beautiful thing hanging behind them. It was a torture device intent on killing you. The cross meant death. And every disciple of Jesus that heard these words knew what Jesus was talking about. He said, you want to follow me? This is where it leads. We lay ourselves down and we love the world and we care for them. It's not about you anymore. We take up our cross and we follow. But Jesus says it's worth it. Verse 24, for whoever wants to save their life will lose it. But whoever loses their life for me is going to save it. Like, what good is it for someone to gain the whole world and yet lose or forfeit their soul? Their very self. Whoever is ashamed of me and my words, the Son of Man will be ashamed of them when he comes in glory. And the glory of the Father and the holy angels. Guys, we got to define the relationship. Jesus draws a line in the sand. He says, which side are you going to be on? Are you with me or are you against me? Are you going to be ashamed of me in this life? Or not? Will you call me Lord? Will you call me Lord no matter what the circumstance? Will you stand with me? Are you going to put your trust in me no matter what? Now, this conversation is happening in the midst of a greater context, okay? Jesus doesn't just drop this heavy language to them. He's asking them questions. In verse 18, he turns to his disciples and he says, who do people say the Son of Man is? Who do people say that I am? All right, who do the crowd say that I am? In verse 19, they reply, some say John the Baptist. Others say Elijah. And still others that one of the prophets from long ago has come back to life. Verse 20, but what about you? What about you? Who do you say that I am? I want you guys to notice that Jesus doesn't really care what the crowds think. What matters is what you believe. What matters is how you respond. He doesn't care what everybody else has in mind. But what do you say? What you believe, it matters. And it's interesting where this conversation takes place. See, in Luke's gospel, in verse 18, it just says they're having a private conversation. They're in a private place. Jesus turns to them and asks this question. But if you flip over to Matthew or Mark's version of the story, this conversation is happening in a very specific location. In Matthew 16, verse 13, it says, when Jesus came to the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, who do people say the Son of Man is? All right, so they're in the region of Caesarea Philippi. That's interesting because maps help if we kind of see where Caesarea Philippi is. Next slide. Maybe? No? There it is. There's. All right. So most of their ministry, Jesus' ministry, happens at the Sea of Galilee. Caesarea Philippi is 25 miles northeast, the very top right corner of that map. Okay? This is a very non-Jewish territory. This is Gentile area. And there's a lot of different beliefs, a lot of different cultural opinions on all sorts of things in Caesarea Philippi. All right, Jesus has gone away from the Pharisees. He's gone away from the crowds. He is in a private location with his disciples, and he wants to have this conversation with them. But it's very important to have this moment here. Jesus is about to set his sights on Jerusalem and the cross that laid before him. And so he's taking his disciples' faith deeper. He's asking questions. He's about to reveal more about his character than ever before, more about his nature to them. And so he comes to this place, Caesarea Philippi. It has so much religious association. There's so much deep-seated belief in this area. In Old Testament times, there to the north where you see Dan there by Benaias there at the top right, this is where Jeroboam, the king, set up the altars on the high places. It angered God because he set up altars to Baal. This is where they worship Baal. For many, many years, he led the people into idolatry. In this area, there are no fewer than 14 temples scattered around Caesarea Philippi. And eventually, the worship of the Baals that you kind of permeated throughout the entire Old Testament led the people to bow down before Greek gods, fertility gods, and goddesses. All right, the area became the religious center of the worship of the Greek god Pan. All right, in Greek mythology, Pan was the god of the wild. He was the god of the forest. He was the god of fright and panic. And the Greeks named the city Panias in his honor. And in the cliff that stood above the city, local people built shrines, and they built temples to honor and worship Pan. There were these niches carved into the stone rock wall above them where they had statues of Pan and his cohorts, and they kind of just stared down at the people. They ruled over the people there, reminding them this is Pan's domain. It was the worship of Pan that people in the area would fornicate, and they delve into all kinds of sexual immorality and indecency. In fact, they would go as far as to say there were some stories that involved people and goats. There was a great cavern in the area that was said to be the birthplace of Pan. Inside the cave was a bottomless cavern filled with this still water. It mesmerized the ancient people. They believed it was the very gateway into the underworld, the very gates of hell. In 3rd century BC, it was a place of human sacrifice to the god of Pan. But from this cave, there was a great water spring that flowed out. It became the very primary source of the Jordan River. It was the same Jordan River that the Israelites parted and entered into the promised land. The same Jordan River where both Elijah and Elisha struck it with a cloak so it would part and they could cross over. It was the same Jordan River where Jesus was baptized. And John came baptizing others. Let's just say that the source of that river had great significance to the Jewish people. It provided the very lifeline, the abundant water supply for the entire land. And because of that river, because of that spring, it was lush and beautiful all around Caesarea Philippi. So much so that it caught the eye of Alexander the Great. He built temples of worship to the Greek gods and goddesses. It was a place where Herod the Great built a temple to Caesar. And it was said in its day, it sparkled in the sunlight with radiance. It was a white marble palace in worship to Caesar. And so, history lesson over. This is the background of where Jesus is in this moment. All right, Jesus and his disciples are entering this region that is soaking with all this religious significance. In fact, the good little Jewish boys would have thought it to be scandalous to be in this area. I mean, that's where the kinky goat people live over there, okay? And there's the cave where people go to worship. And over there, I can see Caesar's worship center just on the hill. And just down the road, that's where the old pagan sites were for Baal worship. They knew all the stories. All right, on the cliff that towers above the landscape, there are carvings and statues in honor of these Greek and Roman gods. Standing above, among all these divine pictures, standing among all these metaphors and ideas and belief systems at the very foot of the spring that brings life to Israel, Jesus challenged his disciples, are you going to worship me or are you going to worship them? Are you going to serve me or are you going to follow them? Is your life going to be fixed on me or all these lesser things? You need to make a choice. Is it me or them? And guys, right now in your life, you've got options. There are no shortage of options. And there's no shortage of opinions on what the world thinks about Jesus. Some say he's a rabbi, he's a teacher, he's a good person, he's a prophet. Others say he's a myth, a heretic, he's offensive and intolerant. Some would say he's an ancient voice that no longer has relevance for our world. He's one of many options in the long line of spiritual buffet choices that you can make to apply to your life. He's just one of many choices. You have options today. You can choose what you believe. All sorts of opinions when it comes to Jesus, but he turns to us today in Luke 9:20. But what about you? Who do you say that I am? For Jesus, it's always personal. It's not about the crowds or the village faith or the religious community surrounding it. It comes down to a personal response. What about you? Who do you say that I am? At some point, you've got to answer that question. And guys, I can tell you, the moment in my life where I answered that question, I've shared this a couple different times over the years, but my family, we grew up in church. My mom made sure that we were faithful on Sunday mornings. Now, we jumped from one church to the next. We moved around a lot, so from one month to the next, it was a different place. But my mom and my grandma, she made sure that we knew about Jesus. I learned about Jesus in Sunday school, in vacation Bible school. I could tell you stories about the heroes of faith and what they did and how that moved and what God did through their life. I could tell you all the stories. I could rattle off scripture. I could say all the right things, and I was really good at Bible Bowl. I could answer questions because I could just input knowledge and spit it right back out. But it wasn't until I was 13 that I actually started wrestling with it. Where I actually started saying, like, what do I actually believe about this? Like, is this my mom's faith? Is this my grandma? Am I doing it to please them, or is there something more here? And I'm telling you, my life, as I started asking questions and God started knocking on the door of my heart saying, take this deeper, go a little bit more here, unpack this. I'm telling you, everything changed the moment I said yes, the moment I made it mine. And I said, this is the life it's not my mom's faith, it's my faith, it's what I believe. And I repented of my sin, I declared Jesus as Lord, I was baptized, I was buried with him in death, and I was raised to new life in that picture of baptism. I can tell you, it was the best decision I've ever made. It was the thing that I needed to know. You see, there's a point where faith has to be owned. It can no longer be somebody else's, it has to be yours. It can't be transferred by association. It can't be, well, my grandma prays for me, so I think I'm good. Or, you know, my mom really wants me to do this, so I'm good. She's faithful, so I'm in. It can't be a coattails faith where you lean on the spouse and say, well, they believe, and so I guess I'm going to be all right. Jesus is looking right at us, looking right at you. Who do you say that I am? What do you believe? What choice are you going to make? Make it personal today. Like, is the Bible just some fictional stories that are nice to read? Or is it truth for everyday life? Did God really make the heavens and the earth? And if so, did God make me? And if God made me, does he have a purpose for my life? Does God want more for me than I could ever begin to understand? Is Jesus really just a teacher, or was he something more? Was he the Son of God? What about the miracles? What about his powerful teaching? What about his death on the cross? Did he really raise from the dead? Is he really coming back for me? These are questions we have to wrestle with. Who do you say that he is? Is he just one of many? Or is he the Son of the living God? The one who brings us to the Father? You have to answer the question. You have to decide. Are you going to follow him or are you going to follow the lesser things? And guys, let me tell you, it's an everyday decision. Because the world's not going to stop giving you choices every single day of your life. I mean, look around you. The world's going to believe all sorts of things. They did it back in Caesarea Philippi. I mean, there was a temple on every corner. There was no shortage of options. And fast forward to today, not much has changed. People bow down and give their hearts and their lives to all sorts of things, whether it's money or entertainment or power or sex or pleasure, you name it. There's no shortage of gods that we can bow down to. And the world will make its choice. Your friends will make their choice, but what about you? Jesus says, forget what they say. I want to know your heart. And this is what Peter responds. He says, Simon Peter answered, you are the Messiah. You are the Son of the living God. And Jesus replied, blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for this was not revealed to you by flesh and blood, but by my Father in heaven. And I tell you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church. And those gates of hell that stand behind us, they won't overcome it. They can't stand against it. There's no power there that can stop what I am doing when you put your faith in me. Church, there is power when the people of God stand together. And Jesus says, when you put your faith in me, when you trust in me, when you follow, and when you gather together as a church, as a body, when my church is established on this rock, when people are bound together by the Holy Spirit of God, the forces of hell will not be able to stand against it. But guys, it starts with a question. Are you all in? Jesus says, will you follow me? He starts with you before he looks at us. Will you follow me? Will you pick up your cross and let me lead? Because listen, guys, hell doesn't shake when people say the name of Jesus and then go on living however they want. The enemy doesn't fear the casual believer or the fair-weather Christian who doesn't actually put their faith into practice. You pose very little threat to the forces of evil when you look and behave like everyone else in the world. But church, when we lay ourselves down and we start serving others, start caring for the needs in our world, when we love deeply and we give generously and we forgive graciously, when we do these things and we shine our light and we go out on mission to seek and save the lost and to set the captive free, when we take up the banner of Christ and live for him with every fiber of our being, when we deny ourselves for the sake of the kingdom of God, the enemy starts to cower and the gates start to shake. So I pray that can be our story today. I pray that God would use your life for his glory. I pray that you would choose to follow him. Let's pray. So God, I pray that you would just draw near to our hearts here in this moment. That you would challenge every single individual in this room to make a choice. Jesus doesn't give us options. Either we're with him or we're against him. We can't be on the fence. We got to make a choice. God, remind us that you love us. Remind us that your blood covers our sin. Remind us that it's not about what we do that saves us. Your blood paid the price. We just simply need to follow. We need to put our trust in you. And we need to let you lead. God, teach us how to do that. And draw men and women to you because of who we are and how we live. God, let your church be bold. Let your church not care about what the world says. But instead, may we lift high the banner of Jesus. God, let that be our purpose. Let that be our goal. Your kingdom come. Your will be done. on earth as it is in heaven, God. Praise in Jesus' name. Amen. So guys, I just want to revisit these verses one more time. Jesus said the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests and the teachers of the law. He's going to be killed and on the third day be raised to life. And then he said to them all, whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves, take up their cross daily and follow me. Whoever wants to save their life is going to lose it, but whoever loses their life for me will save it. What good is it for them to gain the whole world and yet lose or forfeit their very self? Whoever is ashamed of me and my words, the Son of Man will be ashamed of them when he comes in his glory and the glory of the Father and of his holy angels. I want you guys to notice that Jesus, the promise of Jesus is always death first and then life. And Jesus, he leads the way. Like, he's not asking his followers to give what he refuses to give. In this moment, when he says these words, he knows the cross lays before him. And he gladly bears it, knowing that because of it, he gains so much more. Jesus went to the cross so that our brokenness could be healed, so our sins would be forgiven. Jesus went to the cross so that a way would be made back for us to come to the Father. Jesus willingly gave everything so that anyone who wants to come can come and have life. His grace is free. It's freely flowing. It's for those who would respond. He invites anyone. He invites everyone. But make no mistake, it is everything in that moment of surrender. When we accept Jesus as Lord and Savior, you declare that he is your Lord. He is your leader. He not only saves you from your sins, but he's going to guide your life moving forward. You surrender your life and you take on his. You die to yourself and you live for Christ. That's the deal. But it's a good deal. And Jesus, he is a good king. And our attitude should be the same as Christ Jesus, who didn't consider equality with God something to be grasped, but instead, he humbled himself. He made himself a servant. He was obedient to death. Even death on the cross. And therefore God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow. Heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue will confess that he is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. And one day he's going to return in power, he's going to return in glory, and he's going to reward the ones who were not ashamed of him. They will reign with him and they will live forever. Is that your story today? Is that what he's going to say on the day he comes back to your life? Because he's talking to you. He's looking at your heart right now. When Jesus comes, is he going to find a heart that's committed to him? Or is he going to find a member of the crowd that says, this is too hard, I'm going to walk away? Make a decision. Define the relationship. Are you all in or not? But make no mistake, we're going to stand before the King of Kings. What he finds in your heart is entirely up to you. And so today we're going to respond. We're going to sing. Myself, Pastor Eric, we're going to be down in front. If you've never accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior, this is a moment where you can come and talk about what that looks like. A moment where you can surrender your life to the King of Kings and start new. It's a moment to repent, to find that forgiveness you need. Today, if you've already made that decision, but you're wrestling with something, if you're going through a battle or a struggle, we're gonna have prayer partners at the front of the room, and they would love to pray with you. They would love to walk that road with you. But let's not let this moment pass without responding in reverence to the King that we worship. Amen? Amen. Let's stand and sing.
darkness we were waiting, without hope, without light. Till from heaven you came running, there was mercy in your eyes. To fulfill the law and prophets, to a virgin came the word. From the throne of endless glory, to a cradle in the dirt. Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit, three in one. God of glory, majesty, praise forever to the King of Kings. To reconcile the lost, to redeem the whole creation, you did not despise the cross. Thank you. For even in your suffering, you saw to the other side, knowing this was our salvation. Jesus, for our sake, you died. King of Kings. And the morning that you rose, all of heaven held its breath, till the stone was moved for good, for the Lamb had conquered death. Thank you. And the dead rose from their tombs, and the angels stood in awe. For the souls of all who'd come to the Father are restored. Thank you. And the Church of Christ was born, and then the Spirit lit the flame. Now this gospel truth of old shall not kneel, shall not faint. By His blood and in His name, in His freedom I am free. For the love of Jesus Christ, who has resurrected me. Amen. Yes, praise God. Yeah. Praise the Father. Praise the Son. Thank you. Praise the Spirit.
Forever to the King of Kings.
Amen. Amen. May we hold that picture as we go through this week, guys, and just know that He is reigning over us in every aspect of our life. Today, if you came prepared to give a gift, there are offering boxes on the back wall, or there's some trays on that back table. We'd love for you guys to give in whatever way you can to the ministry of the church here. I want to share with you guys a couple quick things before you leave. First off, we have our work camp meal that's happening tomorrow night. Some of you have signed up and to bring some desserts. Others are going to come and serve the meal. But if you want to come and help, it's a pretty simple thing. We're just going to have fried chicken and the fixings for the kids that work at the care center. You can come just serve a plate to them, smile, and just tell them that God loves them as they go out and share the love of God with others. So it's a great opportunity. If you're going to serve, be here by 5:45 tomorrow night. There's a sign-up sheet on the welcome counter as you go out. We've been talking about the Bible reading plan the church is going to do. We're starting it this Saturday. It's going to start on Saturday, so you got to remember that. It's designed to start on a Saturday, June 25th. If you haven't signed up, there is a form in your bulletin. There's also a sign-up sheet out on the counter. If you leave today, if you put your name on that, what that's going to do is I'm going to send you a group code. And that group code is going to connect you to our group on the app. You can download the app and follow those instructions. If you don't want to do the technology side of things, there are brochures that have the whole reading plan just in writing and in paper form you can have as you go out from this place. Wednesday night, we've got our adult class here at church. We'd love to have you with us. As we go from this place, may God just move through us as a church to bring life and hope to everyone that we see. May we not show up for the experience. May we show up for Jesus and feast on Him. Amen.
Amen.
God bless you guys. Happy Father's Day. Enjoy.